Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows your name, and they're always glad you came. You wanna be where you can see our troubles are all the same. You wanna be where everybody knows your name.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome back. Welcome to another wonderful show. It was just one day off, I think. I can't remember anymore. Everything's going weird. I hope you're having a wonderful night. I hope you're enjoying yourselves. I hope you're ready for a little bit of light entertainment tonight. I'm sure you're all aware. I mean, you clicked on the video. We're going to be talking about Daenerys's, is that how you say it? Debut comic, Emilia Clarke. We've brought in a ringer, the Wheezing Moon, the Laughing Moon, Mr. Cunnel Moon himself. Him and I are well practiced now in the art of internet cringe. So I'm sure it will be a fantastic show. But before we get into it, I must do what I always do and welcome all you wonderful people here in the chat. So let me scroll right back up to the top and see who's up there waiting for us. We have Mr. Dojo Coon Comics here. There's my lovely wife in the chat, saying hello to someone else's lovely wife, which is just phenomenal. Very, as you could tell, we're straight off the bat, very misogynistic in here. Although I have seen, Mel's been getting into arguments with people on Twitter today over this. She was told that her opinions will make her very popular amongst all the us dude bros. So there you go. That is clearly what's happening. Us dude bros approve of the lady bros, the sisters. No, that's even worse. The ladies in the chat. God, let me get this show started. 2 minutes in already. Here we go. Insaniacs Draws is here. Welcome, Mo Biggs. Hello, Rick Saylor. Hello, Lam Gigante. Hockey's in the house. Black Rose Comics. Good stuff, Comic Skater. Who else is here? Who else? Osgrade Sage is here. I already just said hockey. Johnny's here. I Borrow Ideas. Great to see you here, my friend. Derek Clay. Who else? I'm totally distracted. I don't know what's going on. I can't remember who I said hello to. I'm going to say random task. Scrolling. We got Crazy Mad in the house. The man with the tiger avatar hailing the chat. Everyone, congratulations. Congratulate Bancroft on 800 backers. Congratulate bros on actually having an entertaining stream. It's a night of firsts. Thank you, Mo Biggs. Thank you. Yes, indeed. For everyone who isn't aware, 800 backers milestone was indeed passed just earlier with the help of Mr. B. Rose and many others, of course, with their promotion. So thank you to everyone. It is an amazing thing to think. 800 people have backed your book. It's pretty crazy. It is pretty crazy. So thank you very much. There's the man himself, Mr. B. Rose. Welcome to the chat. Who else do we have in here? Who else? Scrolling down, looking for new faces. Mr. Rob Arnold in the chat. Welcome, Rob. One of the places that I went and promoted the Lucent to get over this little milestone hump was actually this show right here. Let me play you a very quick little thing of this. Here's Rob in the chat with me on Pete Sametti's show. This happened yesterday. I took a day off streaming, so I thought, well, you know, may as well jump onto Open Mic Monday and spruik myself. And this is what happened.
All right. Rob says, Pete, remind Bancroft when I came on, I promoted his book because I'm better than he is.
He did promote
your book. He did.
He did.
Yeah. So back the Lucent.
three backers away.
I just wanted Rob to relive that. Thank you so much, Rob, for promoting the Lucent and promoting the Lucent and make sure you go out and back the Lucent. You know, one of the good things about getting a few more backers as we're heading to print is that I'm creeping back up towards replicator money numbers. The race might be back on, which would be very exciting. I get to bring the ticker back. Maybe the memes will flow again. It's all good things. We have Rising Star Comics in the house. Jasper Player 9 is here. Stephen Rockwood. Michael Starts on Time Bancroft. That's my new nickname, everyone. Saw it right there. It'll happen every day, every night from now on. We'll be starting on time. Jaded One Art is here. Revenant, welcome. Welcome, Hicks Villain. Simonon 7. How many? We're 5 minutes in. I better get the show started. Scrolling down. How's your father? He says, no need to thank me. Well, I'm not thanking you, but I'm saying hello. Welcome. Welcome. Thank you. Oh, damn it. I won't say thank you for being here, but welcome nonetheless. Rob's laughing at that one. All right. I've wasted enough of your time already. Oh, I didn't want to forget him. Mr. Eric Weathers. Hello there. Oh, and KSS as well. And Lola. So many great people in here. Welcome, everybody. Got 65 people in here, including Don Chin and Checkpoint. I got to get this thing started. Whoa. It is the ultimate albino Thunderbuns. Welcome.
Yeah,
my friend.
I decided to wear something that makes about as much sense as Daenerys' comic.
Right, right. Yeah, you've got the, what are those Russian hat things called? I want to say babushka, but it's not that. That's no, just that, like a Russian.
That's like a Russian grandmother.
Oh, okay. Oh well. Joe looks like a spider. Here's the ultimate warrior with sunnies and a Russian. I've worn one of those hats.
Yeah,
Switzerland.
It was Nikolai like Volkov hat.
Negative 25 degrees Celsius. Mm-hmm. The ultimate Thunderbuns, says Edwin the Ace. Indeed. Yeah, I dig it. I dig it, man. It looks better than that cover we saw on that. Now, speaking of bringing in the ringers, the experts on all things cringe and weird, it's time to bring on my wonderful friend and the person I stream with on Camel Nights.
Sorry about that. I was just getting rid of some nose hairs. I didn't know we were live.
The intros as you come onto the show, everyone's going to start upping everyone else. I like it.
It's called an Ushenka.
Is it? Do you know that?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
How do you know that? You're a bit of a hat aficionado?
No, I Googled it like 13 seconds before.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you've got the internet. Right.
Yeah.
Can you swing around? That. Yeah. Can you swing around on those nose hairs like Spider-Man?
Armpit hairs. I'm better with those.
Nose hairs too short. Armpit hairs, clearly. Mm-hmm. They're very long and they have high tensile strength. Rob points out, I never call him a wonderful friend when I bring him on.
Rob, we are so wonderful friends now. It used to be. Used to be mortal enemies.
Yeah.
When he called me Munchy Moon.
You call him lots of other names, though, to be fair.
Yeah, not when I'm around. But
guys, this occasion calls for a celebration. I nearly finished my Spring Bay.
All right.
Whiskey bottle. And I think I'm going to have a little drinky poo. Because, as mentioned earlier, this did indeed happen. Right there.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
Look at that. Eight. Mm-hmm. It begins with an eight.
I will.
It is phenomenal.
I will join you in libations. I have a beer.
Oh, excellent!
Yeah, and my wife gave me some fruit snacks.
Oh, they're together at last, huh? Beer and fruit snacks,
like peanut butter and jelly.
Well, I needed a snack that was, that wasn't very crunchy, so that I can eat it without you screaming at me. So.
Red Boar's asking, "Where's his standees, Moon Man?"
They're getting made.
Large Giganti says that's not VB. Yeah, I know. Whiskey has much lower calories in it.
This is a whiskey ale.
Oh, that's interesting. But Rob points out I'm still losing. Yeah, I think Rob's on like 41,800. That's within striking distance, Joe. That's well within. We've covered that distance before. Mm-hmm. So this the game may be afoot, which is very exciting. So cheers to everyone in the chat who backed the Lucent. I hope you enjoy it. Ching, ching, ching. I was doing a labor of love. What is it? It was like the task that no one wants to do. It's putting together the final print copy of the unedited edition and having to look at those pages.
I can't believe you even sold that. I would have burned it.
Well, it's people want. Well, it's a testament to Joe's editing skills. Essentially, it's like she can shop that around and say, "Look what I can do for you. Look what you start with. Look at this. I can polish this turd into a shining diamond."
I'm gonna need at least 5 comps of the Crackhead cut and then the final book. It'll make my career.
Done. Yeah. All right. All right. Let me stop sharing this. Whoa, I haven't had a whiskey in ages.
How's it going?
It's
had a little bite?
A little bit of bite. I didn't remember that. But, you know, that's what happens.
Well, that's what happens when you buy the cheap shit.
Oh, this is not cheap. No.
That's not.
This one comes like hand numbered. I don't know if you can make that out. But I got bottle 124 from Cask 45. That's Australia's best single malt whiskey. I think it actually won a global award for best whiskey. But, you know, I haven't had it for a while. All right, what are we doing here? What has happened? Craziness has happened. What do they say? Please, God, make my enemies ridiculous or something like that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a paraphrase, but it is something like that. And not that Emilia Clarke is my enemy, but... Maybe we here over in Comicsgate are in competition with whatever is happening over there in mainstream comic books.
Well, the ideas that she's pushing, I think it's fair to say, are your enemy.
They're the enemy of all things decent.
The sane and well-adjusted, yeah.
Are we going to read this, or are we just going
to... We have to read some of it, man. Yeah. We have to. it's not cheap. There's handwriting on the... That's right. I mean, you can't hand write on some mass-produced thing. This is like...
It was a limited batch.
It's a limited batch, exactly. Sar says, welcome, Sar. Is that milk from a horny kangaroo? No, that's a much more milky white... substance. We've seen how that's obtained too, and it's nothing pretty. This is a proper whiskey. Emilia Clarke, why not add her to your yeah, right? I know. How do I get all these enemies? Rob asks, her secret weapon is her period. It is indeed. Well, it's the source of her powers, I think. You obviously haven't read this, Camel Moon.
I read parts of it, but then you told me we're going to read it, so I didn't want to read too much so I can keep a surprise.
No, it is the gift that keeps on giving, so I think we're going to have to.
Oh, joy.
We're going to have to. I'm not going to read this, but I'm going to agree with it without really knowing all the details.
You don't know that.
I'm going to assume.
You have no idea. That could be the greatest whiskey you've never tried.
Yeah, let's move on. Let's move on. All right. And this is Emilia Clarke talking here. As a kid in London, Emilia Clarke got a distinct vibe from her comic book shop. No girls allowed. I'm just going to say straight up.
I don't believe you.
Like, I don't think she ever went into a local comic book shop. I don't think if she did... there was any vibe being felt or, you know, perpetuated. I think that's just Emilia Clarke looking for an angle to sell a book. That's my opinion. I may be wrong, but I'm just going to put it out there. Steve Worcester points out men can have periods too. Yeah, this whole thing is she is walking a tightrope of transphobia through this whole thing. So she better watch out. This is eggshell territory. You get in here, women and periods. We saw even the president of the United States called them people who birth or something like that. We can't be transphobic in our language.
Didn't J.K. Rowling say something about how women have periods and that's what makes them women?
Oh, yeah. She's been canceled. So
yeah, that was one of
that's my point, though.
Kick her to the curb.
Like, she was trying to, extol the virtues of her lived experience and decry the erasure of however many billion women from the planet. And, therefore she must be eradicated, don't you know?
Rob worked at a comic shop in England. He says it's more of a just no people wanted. Not a guy girl thing, just a people thing. Like, get out. I'm trying to eat my ramen or something.
Yeah, that's true of every comic store in the world, though.
Not my local. My local guys are fantastic, and they're doing really well. That just goes to show a little bit of customer service goes a long way. Amelia Clark, who you may remember from her Oscar-winning performances in Solo, A Star Wars Story, and Terminator Genesis. Oh, they flopped. Well, at least everyone loved Game of Thrones. Oh, wait, no. They hated it.
Did they actually say that? It says remembered for Terminator Genesis?
No, that's just what KSSS said.
Oh, I was like, yeah, I don't think they would want to throw that in there.
Model V says, I hate to say it, but it's shit like this. It's going to make guys into the sorts of things they claimed happened. Well, possibly. The Emmy nominee and lead of the HBO pop culture juggernaut Game of Thrones. She was one of the leads. It was an ensemble cast. Let's not exaggerate things. Was therefore doomed to spend her... I love that language. To spend her adolescence. Oh, poor Amelia. Reading hand-me-down comics from her older brother and meeting caped crusaders on the big screen, she said. What an existence. What a poor existence she had there. She says, I read a lot of fantasy novels full of rich worlds as a child, like Lord of the Rings. I remember all those children out there reading Lord of the Rings, even amongst the fellas. It was a very nerdy young lad who's diving into the Lord of the Rings. Do you want to read that as a young adult?
Do you think that maybe she's referring to when she watched Fellowship of the Ring in the movie theater and read the cast list before she walked out?
There you go. Technically.
Reading the Lord of the Ring? Yeah.
Mrs. Goodstuff says, I wouldn't read this for a million Tampax. So anyway, Game of Thrones, blah, blah, blah. I was amazed. Oh, she went to the Comic-Con for the first time at 22. And she was amazed at what she saw. Almost entirely men.
What Comic-Con did she go to?
It was San Diego Comic-Con, but it also begs the question. So when you were, supposedly locked out of your local comic shop as a kid.
Kicked out.
Kicked out. That didn't, clue you in into the horrible nature of the situation?
No. This is a shocking revelation. But Carol Moon's right. Wow. I mean, I don't go to conventions, but I've seen the pictures, I've seen the videos. There's women everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. And also, how old was she when 22? Like, what was that? Like 07?
Not that long ago. Yeah, not that long ago.
Okay, so...
Oh, well before her time.
Well, no, I, the reason I bring it up is that, I mean, depending on how... Does anyone know how old she is? Because I don't want to speak at it.
I would say she looks to be early 30s.
Late 20s. Early 30s, yeah.
Okay. So... In 08, when The Dark Knight came out, that was the beginning of the sort of renaissance of sort of like comic fandom that we see today. And that's where it kind of went mainstream and actually started supplanting what would normally be a lot of girls getting into sports as sports fans. They would instead go into cosplay stuff and video games and all that stuff. And video games actually came even a little bit before that. So the idea that she went to a con, which I'm assuming is around this time and didn't see any women, is completely idiotic and stupid. Doesn't make any sense.
Not only that, but Danger Vanessa is bringing in the facts. She said born in 86, she's 34. So
if you're talking 10 years ago.
Well, she said no women. When she was 22.
Entirely men.
So 12 years ago, right?
Yeah.
Would have been 2009. Now, I went to San Diego.
Height of it, yeah.
I went to San Diego Comic-Con in 2008, and there were women everywhere.
Yeah.
Are you guys saying that she's being deceptive here and just drumming up a fake controversy to promote a book? Are you guys making that accusation?
These are the types of arguments that these people make because you need to have a time machine to prove them wrong. So it's all just assumed. And she can say, honestly, whatever she wants, because now if you argue against her, then you're the guy who's the sexist, right? You're the guy who's trying to put her in her place and not just going with whatever her narrative is, even though it completely contradicts any fact that anyone with a fucking camera and a Facebook account from 12 years ago can prove wrong.
I was just going to say, if I were to dig out my pictures from that 08 Comic-Con, just random pictures. There would be men and women and children in every one of them. Because the place was
pointing out here, Joe, you wouldn't have rested until you've laid those beady eyes on every single woman in attendance there.
Well, I mean,
just to make sure that they were women.
I'm nothing if not thorough. Yeah. I mean, surely our working relationship is.
Rob Brecker, she got her. She got those numbers from the men's room.
She got those numbers from her publicist, who also didn't know what the fuck they were talking
about. There you go.
Anyway, later, as tides turned in the industry and hashtag Me Too emerged, she began to look at the community through those eyes, and it was arresting for her. She's led a very troubled life. She's led a very troubled, oppressed life, this woman. So let's all look at it through that lens. Let's remember.
Stunning and Clark, brave.
Clark started dreaming about what a comic book might look like from her perspective, a notion that quickly gained steam. Well, she did obviously clearly didn't know that there's no women in comics. Women are not allowed to be in comics, not allowed to make comics, they're not allowed to read comics. They're not even allowed to step within the door of a comic book shop.
We're not allowed. They're not allowed anywhere.
Keep dreaming, Amelia. But anyway, she went against the curve and she recruited an all-female creative team and made a comic featuring what is undoubtedly one of the most progressive female heroes in the genre. And doesn't that all get your private parts tickling when you read about the most progressive female hero in the entire genre? I know my wallet's just like flipped open all of a sudden. Ready to buy. It's gonna be amazing. Mom. I say mom. You guys say mom.
Mom.
Mother of Madness will publish in July at Image Comics, and it'll be essentially made by these two people, and Amelia Clark will be pushed to the front. I'm sure. This bit is interesting here. I like this bit. In doing my research, I found that 16% of comic book creators are female, according to one study, and only 30% of comic book characters are women. Notice the full stop. I think we're outside the realms of the study now, because it goes on to say, on the other hand, roughly half of comic book buyers are female.
Bullshit!
Yeah, I don't think so. I do not believe. I do not believe.
Well, that's also one of those juke stats because, it accounts for manga as well.
All right. Yes. Okay. No, we got to. Okay. So we got to count Scholastic, which goes into schools. So, that would make a lot more sense. We got to count manga. We've got to count basically everything except what we've traditionally right. Everything talk except about for when we talk wearing, about
yeah, muscle bound, Western, ironclad, all that.
I mean,
stuff.
Despite the fact that we are talking about it, said right here, heroes genre. We're just gonna I'll stand corrected. I'm man enough to admit when I'm wrong. If that roughly half number is from a real study, there you go. Okay.
Yeah.
When was the last time a legit creator without a Hollywood resume got an article to promote their number one issue? We're going to chat about that as well. I think this is part of a new trend that might be starting up here. This is like behind this whole thing. Continuing on. So Maya is the character. She's a busy single parent because that's obviously, you know, everyone wants to read about that in their comic books. Upended by the discovery of superhero. She's a single mom that's got to get shit done. Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you this, though. Two things. One, what kid is like, man, when I'm an adult and I'm a single busy parent, am I going to want to read a comic about being that? There's no fantasy there. Second, let's say you are a busy parent. Who wants to finally relax after putting the kids to bed and picking up the vomit and the laundry and all this to sit down and read the same fucking thing happening?
Yes.
I mean, why would you want to? That's not an escape. That's torture.
Not only that, but single parents know what it's like. I mean, it's not super heroic. I mean, they do it because that's life. They're living their life. They're taking care of their responsibilities. It's admirable. I mean, it's difficult, extremely difficult, but you talk to a single parent. None of the ones that I know would describe themselves as superheroes. I mean, I don't even know what her name is, the character, but you know, with her armpit hair that allows her to swing through the city like Spider-Man, you know, that's...
Oh, we'll get to that.
That's super. Weird. Maybe that's super, but I wouldn't call it super heroic.
Snake Oiler has an idea here. He wants a comic about reading, like chatting on YouTube.
Now there's an idea.
Our hero spends his days watching Comic Skate streams, chatting on YouTube and sending super chats.
You can
read about it too.
Wasn't that one of the new X-Men that came out though? It was like someone who had like a
yeah. He was
always on his phone,
on
like
his
that's
phone
the greatest.
And everything.
Is that internet gas?
No. Different thing. Oh, okay. Different
and,
thing.
And that's
he was
actually
like,
what
he was. Is. He has a TikTok. He had a TikTok. Yeah. And it was hilarious. This is I'm pretty sure Jordan Peterson spoke about this, and obviously we're going to get into generalizations here. When I say women, I mean in general. When I say men, I mean in general. Men, when they read things, they like to read about things that aren't them, mm-hmm. like Batman and Star Wars and whatever.
Speak for yourself. I mean, you don't know what I'm
about
doing tonight.
Adventurers and all sorts of things. Escapism, essentially. Whereas women, when they read things and consume media, they more want to have themselves transported into the story so they can sort of fantasize that they're the character in the story. This has been well documented in psychology and everything, and that's why I think with a lot of these female created things, you get a lot of that. You get a lot of, hey, I'm going to insert myself into this story. And men just saying, they're like, who would read this stuff? Which is a problem, because she just pointed out she went to the comic convention or whatever she was, and she saw mostly men.
You're putting way too much thought into this, Mike. I guarantee you, you're putting five times as much thought into this as she did into writing her comic.
No, that's fine. He's allowed to do that. Somebody has to do that. Because the more and more people that decide that, you know, it's fashionable for me to go out and just like Keanu Reeves is making money, I can make money. You know, this will be a thing that I can do, you know, to boost their street cred, get a little bit of internet clout. And honestly, I mean, what the fuck has Emilia Clarke done? So she's clearly just looking to either virtue her way into another role, or she's bored. She has no idea what to do next. And she's like, this could be a quick, easy buck. You know, who is she to write anything? Is she a writer? Remember when J.J. Abrams' kid was writing a comic?
What was that? Sorry?
Remember when J.J. Abrams' kid was writing a comic?
Oh, yeah.
It was just well, who are you to write anything? You're not a writer. You're an actor. You take other people's stuff and you translate it. And when you try to do it yourself, you come up with this insipid idiocy because you don't know what the fuck you're doing. You know, to say that, what's the percentage here? There's only 30% of women in comics. Well, maybe if that's true, it's because the ideas are about moms whose periods are their superpowers and nobody wants to read that shit. Because it doesn't sell books.
I think this isn't clear. Another clear case of, someone who isn't. Who isn't actually trying to sell books, but we'll get into that in a second. Towards the end. Ethan covered this just earlier, and he made a very interesting point. He said most of these people like this, they don't try to create new things. They try and essentially rework existing stuff because that they destroy things, essentially. They're parasites. They latch onto already popular things and, just eat it from the inside out. So it is always pretty funny when they do the thing, which is, no, I'm going to actually create something new. Now, this actually isn't that new. There's, this sort of thing exists in the past. Here we have, I think this is Eric Larson.
That looks like his work.
Yeah. They don't call me Heavy Flow for nothing.
Jesus God.
There you go. So it's not like the idea of a period powered hero is original, but at the very least, she's kind of
first of all trying. If I may, it's not a power to have a period. Every woman has a period. It's a power to not have a period, really. Like, so I don't know why. Yeah, that's what it is. So, no, but I mean, it's just like, you can't say like this, like, that would be like if I was to make a comic about a dude, I was like, his power is to pee standing up. You would be like, mm-hmm. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
You could do erection power, but I don't think that would go down very well. Like, my power comes from my erection. And yeah, I don't know how that would go. Yeah, it's funny, no one really... It is weird. Actually, I've got this pulled up somewhere. Who was it? It was just some guy. Here it is here. He said, can someone explain the feminist obsession with the periods? No one cares about your periods. No one wants to share it with you. It's like taking a shit with the door open. Don't. Which I think is a great point because it does keep coming up. They do keep going back to the period. And obviously, I kind of understand why. It's something that only women can do. But at the same time, it is a bodily function. It's not, it's not some magical source. It's not the Infinity Gems, is what I'm trying to say. Like you pointed out, billions of people around the planet go through this monthly process. So it is a strange thing to focus in on. Woodrow for $5, the Lego study strikes again. What's the Lego study? Is that where they get all this information from? Must be.
I sent you a link. This was from Vice. And this, proves your point about the period stuff.
Yeah, Jasper Plan 9 is thinking the same thing I am. Chelsea Kane already did the menstrual magnum opus with man-eaters. Ladies who turn into wolves according to their monthly cycle.
Vice, of course it's Vice. Why period sex is the best sex and should probably be mandatory. Okay.
No!
Closing that down.
You don't need to read it. But I want to throw it out there because, again, it's like you were saying, it's like it's become part of this popular conversation to throw out there. And it's like this is, I don't know why you think this is something that everyone needs to get on board with.
Also as well, there's always a big talk about, it's so maligned and it's so shame, like women ashamed to this. I don't see that anywhere. And then maybe that's my male privilege. I just don't see it. Like no more shame than any other bodily function that you might do, out there, around there. It is a bizarre thing, but, people do need their narratives. Rob did send me something. Hold on a sec. We don't want Rob upset if I don't show it. He said he sent me the character design for this new character. Let me stop sharing that. Start sharing this. So this is Maya, is it? Maya? There you go. Thank you, Rob. I'm going to stop sharing that straight away.
Transform. All right.
where is it? Here is it back. Here you come back again. Because we haven't even gotten to the good stuff yet, fellas. The meat in this sandwich is yet to come. So she's a single mom that's got to get shit done. And she's a poet and she doesn't even know it. This is born from an idea that single mothers are superheroes, which is a pretty bogus idea. You need superhuman strength to do that.
Okay, sure, whatever.
Like, I'm pretty sure that raising a child is not superhuman, given the fact that billions, untold billions of people have done it, to lead us to this point. And there's billions of people out there doing it at the moment. Rob says, lol, worth it. Well, it was for you. I don't know if it got many laughs in the crowd, but...
You got sobs. You got cringes.
When you get into your 30s, your friends start having kids, you're like, oh my God, I was not aware of what it took. Raising kids is hard. It's not lifting a car above your head and throwing over a building hard, but it's hard in other ways. It's very tiring. That is true. Well, so if like being awake with 4-5 hours sleep is a superpower, sure. Okay, I'll give you that one.
The thing is, too, is, and this speaks to the clearly someone who actually comes from privilege. If you think having a kid requires superpowers, then what kind of charmed, frosted life have you led to get to this point?
Exactly.
You know, because it's like, oh my God, it's so daunting and it's so exhausting. And, like nobody has ever done this before. I need to tell a story about my plight. Shut the fuck up. Shut up. You know, go sit by the pool, relax, and shut up.
It's almost like your millions of dollars.
Yeah, yeah. Like, you're not doing anything that hasn't been done before. Many Emmy nominations. Go make, go find a cure for cancer. Go build a rocket ship that can land itself. Actually do something. And then, tell me.
She's doing something. She's making a new superhero that is going to be lasting the test of time.
That's not doing anything.
It's almost like she read The Legend of Single Parents and then decided that it needed to be adapted into comic book form.
Yeah.
Vilned really likes your attire, Camel Moon.
Thank you. Is it the hat? Or
there's one person out there who digs your style. One
guy who likes my Hot Topic hat. Other than me, okay.
All right, now we're getting into the juicy part. Another key identifier for the character is that all of her powers manifest from her menstrual cycle. Of course they do.
Hey!
That's, forget radioactive spiders and gamma rays. Just a natural menstrual cycle is all you need.
Uh-huh. And,
so here we get into it. Okay, the bloating, the hair growth, the mood swings, and the acne. All of it.
Yes,
we hate it when it happens. Speaking for myself and everyone I've ever met who's had a period. Okay, all right. I'm not really with you at the moment, but let's see where you're taking this. What if we turned that around and made the period something that we can feel as this unique, crazy, superhuman thing that happens in our body? Are our wallets open?
My ass is open.
So open.
What a premise. What a premise. And yeah, like I said, I mean, amazing that no one has thought of this before except everyone who has.
And I want to be treated different because of the thing that, you know, classifies me as a person that I shouldn't actually try to identify as.
And Danger Vanessa points out the boob growth. Yeah, boob growth is the best part of it. I mean, maybe not for the woman because I do hear it is uncomfortable and hurts. But
it's good for everyone else. We prefer
everyone else. It is a good time. Atomic Bukaki for $2. Thank you so much. Says better make a good sandwich. You would hope so. You would hope so. A woman's ability to make a good sandwich is essential. Even in today's feminist age, even in the post Me Too era.
Do you think that when she goes super powered once a month, that her sandwich making skills increase?
I bet you were complaining maybe. Skills increase.
And now that I think about this, is this like a werewolf thing? Is this like a transformation thing? It comes around once a month and
it sounds that way.
She better not get pregnant because she's like, I need to fight this bad guy, but I'm late, so I can't.
Maybe it's like a Super Saiyan monkey thing.
So like maybe the other 3 weeks of the year, she'll make a 6-inch, you know, sub sandwich. But during that week, you get a 6-foot long sub sandwich. Yeah.
Everything is just like super powered.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Because of the period, obviously. When Maya is scared, she goes invisible. That's handy. When she's angry, she has superhuman strength. Oh, okay, so she's just Captain Marvel. She's just whatever she needs to be, she is. Because women are strong.
Oh, no, no, look. She swings like Spider-Man from her arm.
Oh, yeah.
I made that up. I thought there was a joke.
No. It's real. She can swing like Spider-Man from her armpit hair. This is just hit.
When the satire is actually, you know, whatever it is they're planning, then you know it's time to quit.
She can do more than anything a spider can.
Oh, yeah. I don't see spiders swinging from their armpit.
If she wants to be like a spider, then she needs to shoot fluid out of her ass. And fly around like that.
Yes. Now, never underestimate the amazingly talented and creative people out there in this little pocket of the internet that we inhabit, because someone has already envisioned this and you know, given us something to look at here. And here it is by Entertainment Madness. He's already.
Drawn. Oh, big holes there. You gotta cut that out.
Drawn a cat. Yeah, exactly. You need free movement with your armpit hair. And I want to know, you know, like when Spider-Man uses his webs, they hang around for at least a couple of hours.
because they
need to stay there. If he hangs a bad guy up on a lamppost, you know, he needs to stay there until the police come. At least.
I wonder what that smells like when the police show up.
Oh, well, it smells like body odor because deodorant is white supremacy. But, you know, do these things, after she swings on them, are they like webbing? Do they – because obviously they shoot out.
Yeah.
So does that mean they get stuck there? Or is it sort of like a shoot out and come back kind of thing? I'm interested in this superpower. I think she's – on this particular one, she's actually hit on a winner. This is new. I've never seen this before.
I've never heard of this before. She throws it like a lasso and then wrangles it back up and then puts it under her armpit.
It's a bit like a Zorro or Indiana Jones.
Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
Whip. It can do anything at once, really. It's sort of like aware.
Memnon in the chat has it. Seems like a relaxing way to travel. She can just recline and let her armpit hair do all the work.
Mm.
Yeah, well, I mean, what a lazy asshole then, really.
Mo Big says, what a way for us to finally find out the real story of Elisa. Damn it. You got me.
Amelia Clark.
Well done. Entertainment Madness. Anyone wants to go follow Entertainment Madness? It's at ET Madness. So well done on that. Very quick too. Look, he's even colored it and everything. And the art is probably, let's face it, on par at least
with what it's going to look like.
What they're going to look like in the book. He would have just ripped that out in 10 minutes. Antoine thinks we're being mean. We need to give it a chance. I'm serious. This is actually pretty creative, the armpit hair swinging thing. You say things like you couldn't make this up. That's getting into that territory. You know, that's like divine intervention that's given her that idea.
Except, around I just made it up randomly.
And it was in the article.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Atomic Pukaki again for $2 and her clitoris becomes Thor's hammer. Oh, God.
It's very heavy.
Ooh, yeah, try and lift
very
that.
Very difficult to lift.
Oh, my God.
Who could ever be worthy?
just herself, I guess.
Definitely not a man.
No.
No man could ever lift up that...
No.
Could ever wield that mighty...
She don't need no man.
Oh, my goodness. Through both lenses, Clark and her creative team sought to lionize the single mum. There we get into it a little bit. That's propaganda. That's like, I'm not writing a story for entertainment value. I am trying to, I've got an agenda here. Whose media depiction is usually one of struggle, sadness, and efforts to rebalance her life with a male partner? I don't know about that. I mean, I'm sure that does exist out there, but I think, the prevailing zeitgeist of the last, at least since I've been aware, has been a you don't need no man kind of thing.
Yeah, this seems like wishful thinking on the part of the article writer.
Well, yeah,
making
line...
up oppression so that you have a good narrative upon which to sell your comic. But look. Fret not, misogynists. Mayer utilizes inflated boobs to help thwart a human trafficking ring. So there's a little bit of something in there for everyone. Men and women alike.
I like this lionize the single mom. I think they mean sodomize the single mom.
Oh, God. Family show. I mean, I know we got into the Thor's hammer... Dolores. But do you remember that Seinfeld episode?
Dolores!
that was one of the best endings ever. Here we get into it here. She's so ashamed of her powers at the start. It's mental. I don't understand this. And if you ladies in the chat, because I know you're here, I see you in there. If you can explain this, are you out there being ashamed that you have a period? Like, is that a thing? Or is it just like, I don't know. As a man, I don't get it. I don't see it. I don't see that out there the media and society is shaming women for having periods. I don't see it. But, you know, as women personally, do you feel shame?
That's
because
an interesting
it seems
point.
Like a very unusual because, thing that it keeps being brought up.
Yeah. If you think about cinema, especially in the 80s where they didn't give a shit, were period jokes ever a thing? No, never. Never, ever. It was never like, she's on the rag today. It was just like, that was never a joke outside of an Andrew Dice Clay bit.
Right.
You know?
That's right. You know, it was always, even when the jokes that were told, they were always kind of told ironically.
Yeah.
As like, oh, I'm acting like some right, tough like guy from the yesteryear.
Yeah, like you wouldn't make jokes like that because that's kind of like beneath us as hopefully as society.
Eddie makes his wife sleep in the garage.
I got to start taking notes.
Yeah, Antoine has it right. It's sort of like, you know, if you rely, female comedians who only talk about their vagina all the time or, just nonstop fart jokes. And then fart jokes, I like a fart joke as much as the next guy, but it is a bit... Danger Vest says shame by society. No, yeah, I didn't think so. I don't see it.
No, It's low hanging fruit.
It keeps being brought up.
Yeah. It's low hanging fruit, and it's what easy thinkers go for when they really have nothing else to talk about.
Mm-hmm. Now, here's the bits again. Let me put in a little preemptive.
I don't believe you.
Topical themes and raunchy humor, blah, blah, blah. Even though they lend themselves to, this, the person who wrote this article thinks this book lends itself to film, which is amazing.
Maybe a snuff film.
yeah, exactly. Where are they watching their films?
But Clark's ambition was not to create a vehicle for the screen, rather an artifact she can enjoy on it. I mean, that, okay, whatever. No, this is a trend. This is a trend, and I want you guys to give your opinions on it right after I read another phenomenal Atomic Bukkake super chat for $2. What kind of bikes do girls ride?
Banana bikes? Banana seats?
Normal bikes? Thank you for the super chat nonetheless. I think that I'm just going to ask it. Is this the new...
I didn't know. That's a funny joke. Go ahead.
Menstrual cycles. Right. I didn't get that. Nothing goes over my head. I am too fast. I would catch it. Here we go. Thank you. Again, Atomic Bukkake, $2. Menstrual cycles. Thank you. Is the comic book now the kind of new way of making a script? Because it's sort of a bit more flashier than a script. It's like, look, I've sold this. There's already an audience. There's pictures. There's so many movies based on comic books. It's the whole rage now. So rather than just writing a script for your Netflix series or your TV, you may have a comic get made. I think everyone realizes that's what's happened with Berserker. That's what it was for.
Mm-hmm.
And now this, another celebrity attached to it. I think this is, they're just going to keep coming, essentially. Do you guys agree? Am I off base? Is it too early to say that?
Well, so I think about like the Gwyneth Paltrow vagina candle, you know, where it's just like, this is the most ridiculous thing ever. Yeah, right. And then it exploded and burned someone or something.
Sorry, I just need to interrupt you one sec. Mo Biggs, my forehead is too high. It would block it. sorry.
It's okay. So I think it's going to be, this is not new. It's like especially now, I would say within the last couple of years, celebrities finding something to attach themselves to as some type of creative project to boost their influence and boost their street cred is not a new thing. And like back in the day, it wasn't as egregious and worthless as it is now. You know, I mean, like Dan Aykroyd had his like Crystal Head vodka. Hugh Jackman had that coffee he was pushing. Mm-hmm. But now it's become a political ideology that they're attaching themselves to because it's fashionable to do so. So I think as long as the woke culture is still hitting every fucking stop on the moron express, we're going to continue to see this stuff until it becomes such a faux pas that people are like, okay, I got to back away from that because I don't want to Amelia Clark myself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is very kind of obvious that the whole premise, the whole kind of way it's being done is it needs to have that, you know, like when you go into American Idol or whatever, you need your sob story. You can't just go in there and sing a song. You know, you need the story behind why you need to sing your song. It's because of your grandmother, you know, on her deathbed, handed you the guitar and said, go follow your dreams. And, you know, you've got to have an angle. You've got to have a narrative. You've got to have, well, you know, in this case, you've got to have something so ridiculous, like what we're reading here, that people will go onto the internet like we're doing right now and laugh at it. So then they can, in turn, go and say, this proves exactly why this is needed. Look at these misogynists laughing at us.
But I think the well, I think that's part of it. I actually think that enough of them don't know that there are enough shows out there like this one where not only do we bring it up, but we point out how incredibly stupid it is. I think a lot of them think we're mostly positive word of mouth, where they're going to get a lot of their sycophantic idiots to, you know, bring this stuff up on their podcasts and talk about what a fantastic idea it is. The problem is, and as we've seen multiple times with like any fucking SJW comic, is like these people don't buy that shit. This comic, at the most, will sell, I don't know, what, 50,000 for its first issue?
Oh,
and then
no.
It'll plummet.
No, I don't.
You don't even think it'll be that high.
Not an image, no. I think
okay,
these,
so maybe 20,000, 10,000.
These strange, yeah. These strange, and they'll make no money from it. We know the numbers. We know the numbers of people when, you know, once they're all done, even selling 20, 30,000 copies, you make, you know, I don't know, $10,000 or something from it.
Yeah, yeah. Especially from someone like Amelia Clark, who doesn't need that kind of money.
Oh, yeah. Back at it again. Another joke for $2. Thank you so much. What's an ovary's favorite type of TV show? Did you guys read the chat?
Mm-hmm.
Ovaries.
Oh, Camel hasn't. What do you think it is?
No.
Can it's I get a period drama.
I was going to guess Rags to Riches.
I actually, thank you for the joke. Thank you for the super chats as well. I'd actually saved Arrogant Ape from the chat had sent pretty much this exact same joke in response to my tweet. I saved it because I did laugh out loud on that. What time in history is this? I asked because I heard it was a period piece. We have the funniest, best people here in the chat. Love it. She will probably just buy all of her own comics. 10K, those numbers are fixed. Antoine says, meh. Tomba says, lol. Chimera says, well done. Straight from the presses to the dumpster. I don't think it's going to go very well. You saw the other cover. Where was it? So that's cover one. This one is cover two. Can I click on? I clicked on it earlier and I just got an ad. Oh, here we go. The old red on red dynamic.
So, I mean, what is number two going to make? I mean, it'll make obviously half. I think it'll probably make less than half of whatever the first issue makes. And it's of three. You know, I mean, so they're looking, I would imagine, to make some type of, like you said, like a three-act structure pitch that they can send off to whoever.
Well, I don't know when in the three-act structure the inflatable boobs come in.
But, it's a backstory.
You'd want it to be sooner rather than later. Why and when did Amelia decide to make a book? Well, we heard from the horse's mouth itself. She was at the conventions and she was like, where are all them ladies at? And I see men everywhere, so I'm going to make a comic book just for the ladies. I mean, it's perfect, makes perfect business sense to anyone who reads it. And
but you're also pandering specifically to women. It's like, you know, I want to use the same exact example, but it's like, it would be like if for whatever reason comic books were always women oriented. And then suddenly they were like, we're gonna appeal to men. What do men do? They pee standing up. All right, well, we'll do a pee standing up thing. The guys like that, right? That's a thing. And we'd be like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, why do you think this appeals to me?
The pee standing up hero.
Yeah. He's a peon.
Scoundrel Pilled says, between mentioning Lord of the Rings and not thinking zombie about trans women don't bleed issue, she's going to be feasted upon by the horde like JK Rowling. She actually does have some diehard fans out there. My wife found that out. She tweeted about this and was descended upon by some very voracious ladies out there who will protect Miss Clark by any means necessary. So we'll see. I'm interested in seeing where this goes. I think it is funny fodder for us to laugh at, but maybe some people out there who, you know, read and review comics will let us know what the how the swinging in your armpit hair goes in the actual story, and importantly, the inflatable boobs, because we're all we all need to know about that. I'm gonna check out Hail Salad on Indiegogo. What's going on over there?
I closed the campaign and refunding everyone. And
oh no! Look, you're on 65,000.
Yeah, look at that. But dollary news.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're over 50 grand. I actually updated the page a little bit. I put some of the other pics in there of the lunchbox and the sunglasses and that kind of stuff, so people can see them. And I, updated the stretch goals so that people had an idea what they were getting. We're, it's going good. I just finished the 28th page of the book. Mm-hmm. I showed it to Bancroft the other night.
Yep, I have seen. I've seen pretty much most of the pages that you've done. I think people are going to be really pleasantly surprised when they get this book.
Yeah, I didn't.
You've been selling it mostly on the standees and the stickers and the lunch box and all that. This is still. I think I voted this my second favorite cover in all of Comicsgate.
Oh yeah, that was.
I love this cover, but I think it's gonna. People are gonna have a lot of fun with this book. Can I just get back to the topic, Rainey? I just need to butt in because we've got an actual lady who makes a comic in the chat, giving her opinion. And she said, "This is not a comic for ladies. Shouju and that manga are comics for ladies. This is for privileged whingers who have nothing to say but want to feel special." Sorry, I.
Well, that's not fair. I tried to make this comic for everyone. I'm really sorry if you were offended.
Yeah, clearly. I mean, look. I mean,
we got ladies. We got strippers. Look at this girl's butt.
Look at little Shane here.
This one has a child, so she's childbearing.
Yeah.
But yeah. So anyway, it's going fine. Well Hung and Dung. He said something earlier that I wanted to bring up. He wanted to know if Liam was in the comic. No, Liam is not. I was on Liam's chat today, and I had all these this one dude attacking me because he was like, you unfairly attacked Liam. And I was like, look, I want to say something here. I want to make it very public. Mm-hmm. I am an equal opportunity offender. If you're in CG, you are fair game. I mean, and everything is done with love. And on top of that, I had a conversation with Liam to be in it. He said, A, he expected it, and then B, sent me the link to the video that I used so I could put him in the cartoon. So if you have any qualms about that whatsoever, just calm down. All right? It's just a cartoon.
Everyone gets lampooned in Hail Salad. Well, I mean, if you make it, and I think it's actually an honor. Like it's a big honor. If you made it into a Hail Salad cartoon,
you've made it. You're
a pride of privilege.
Yeah.
If you haven't,
try harder. Do
more. And stop sucking less.
Yeah.
And stop get sucking in there. As much. Yeah. No, we don't.
But it's going great. I'm not anticipating taking the campaign down at any point, so you guys can get in there.
Well, you haven't even finished the comic book yet, so. Wait until that happens.
So the most likely the next big update is going to be of the interior art. Hopefully that'll get us a bunch of more people. Because you're right. I mean, we haven't really put a whole lot of art out. And I think Bancroft told me specifically if I had launched with art, I actually might have made more money. So that's...
Who could have thought of that, Joe? Who would have imagined actually putting some comic book art on your comic book campaign? And there's people in the chat who don't even know you have a comic book. They thought that's just like standee gate.
Yeah, crazy talk.
Yeah, well, it's coming. It looks great. I enjoy drawing it.
Oh, it does look like a lot of fun. It does look like a lot of fun. Speaking of a lot of fun, the Lucent Waking Dream, we mentioned it earlier. Like I said, thank you to everyone, 801 backers.
Oh, yeah.
I think we're over. Is we've gone back to Australian dollars, but I think it's over 40,000 we saw earlier. I've mentioned, but maybe you're new here. I don't know. If you are, we have proof copies in hand. There's the main book. Everyone gets this. Everyone also gets a 10-page preview of the second book. Everyone gets prints, cool art prints, A4 prints. Oh, and everyone gets this.
A ginger. Is that a monkey paw?
No, it's a ginger root hand.
Be careful, everyone. Bancroft's sending you monkey paws. Don't make any wishes.
They're legal. They're legal. They won't get stopped at customs. I promise. I promise. Well, that was a great show. I had a great discussion. That was lots of fun. I think that is one of the more ridiculous stories to come out in the last month. I did not expect it. I did not wake up this morning thinking I'd be reading about a superhero who swings on their armpit hair like Spider-Man, powered by their menstrual cycle. Lo and behold, here we are. So I had a lot of fun talking about it. Thank you, Camel, for coming on and partaking in the discussion. Thank you, Joe. Sorry, the ultimate Thunderbuns, for joining us today. The biggest thank you of all is always reserved for the wonderful people here in the chat, the sexiest chat in all of CG. Thank you all so much for coming out and hanging with us tonight. We will see you again tomorrow night for another fun show. Until then, I hope you have a great night. And see you then. Bye.